This
agenda
conference will now be recorded.
Is the agenda itself, and Ted had made a suggestion by email, and I agree that I think that we should move number four, which is the discussion of the land development regulation amendments, down below 5, 6, and 7, so we can kind of get those shorter agenda items out of the way and make sure we have enough time to cover them tonight. Because I think item four may be more than we can cover in tonight's meeting. So, Monica?
Yeah, and I just was going to quickly ask, before last meeting, Paul sent some maps to us, and then we never discussed those in last week's meeting. So I was wondering, and they relate to four. You know what I'm talking about? There was an email that we had all received about the maps that related to Article 12, and then we did not discuss them in that last meeting. So I was going to ask if we could just be, when we're in four, to also discuss what he had sent to us that past week.
Yes, and I have actually last night at the council meeting, I did present a series of maps that have the Article 12 items as presented in this draft. So we do have maps available we can look at. So any issues with moving four down the agenda?
That's fine.
Okay, we'll plan to do that. Okay, open to the public for items not related to the agenda. And just for reference, you can turn on your speaker and speak. You can turn on your camera and wave. Okay, I'm not hearing anyone and not seeing anything in the chat right now. So I think we can move on to the announcements. I guess, as I said, I did talk with the council last night about the chapter 10 and 12 items. But I think I'll give more of an update as we talk through that agenda item, since it is on the agenda tonight. Anyone else have anything? Ted?
Yeah, yesterday I listened to the community wildlife update. I guess some of you watched it or was part of it before, dealing with the updating the town plan of Act 171. Interesting, but maybe not quite as relevant for South Burlington. It was really 10, I thought it was more relevant to Jericho and the middle part of the state, more, you know, the forests and so on. But it's still, there are some interesting aspects with regard to wildlife, and I'm not sure if everyone now has gotten a chance to see that, but it was good.
Yeah, I've only looked at half of it and then was distracted by something else. Yeah.
Monica, go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. I just can't recommend this book highly enough. Guys, we're reading it with the Affordable Housing Committee, and I know that they're working with the public library to actually organize a community book conversation about it. I actually did the Audible, I admit, and it was very easy to multitask with it. But I sincerely would ask you all to consider spending some time with it. Thank you.
It's called The Color of Law. Who's the author there? And you are on mute, so maybe you can even.
All right, Richard Rothstein.
Rothstein,
right?
Great.
Yes, it's a really impressive book, and it spells out a long history of inequity, all the way from federal down to local policy in communities all across the country for a century. And even if not overtly in some communities, you know, given how much communities sort of copy other communities and what they've done, and states copy other states, the sort of lineage of some of the assumptions that go into policy is really sort of eye-opening. Mm-hmm.
I really like seeing everyone. Right now we're like this perfect 9-box square on my screen. So. I didn't say hi well enough at the beginning. Hi. Any other announcements? Paul?
Just two quick ones. I think I mentioned in the in your packet that the council would be talking about the amendments that you passed along to them last month. The council unanimously adopted them last night. And also I gave a brief update to the council on some work that we've gotten going with the Energy Committee about getting going with a climate action plan to meet the council's 2017 resolution on that subject. And there's going to be a lot of different tentacles of that work, and some of that may come directly to you, and some of that is what you're working on right now. And I relayed that to council last night also. So more to come on that soon. That's all I got.
Okay, then we can move on to item five, which is the Regional Planning Commission's Unified Planning Work Program potential projects. So
So just briefly, as a reminder, every year the Planning Commission makes a series of recommendations to Council, and then Council decides to, on a priority list, to submit to the Regional Planning Commission. Staff provided you our proposed list. I do have one addition to it. After talking with the Bike Ped Committee representative to the group, as well as our Public Works Director, we felt that one more bike ped project really ought to get scoping, which is the section of the planned rec path along Kimball Avenue as it goes by Potash Brook. It's sort of a tricky spot right there. And while we do have plans for how to connect it further west, it's relatively straightforward. Right over the Potash Brook is going to be a tricky spot. So we'd like to have the Regional Planning Commission help us scope that so that we can get it in the queue for future financing. And we'd recommend that be the fourth priority under transportation.
Michael?
Paul, on the map that shows that there's a gap between where it ends at Potash Brook coming from Williston direction, and then it picks up on the other side of the road. Is that a correct, if I look at the map?
On the other side of the road is a sidewalk, Michael. What the Bike Ped Committee has been talking about with the O'Brien brothers as they've been designing the what they're calling East View neighborhood, which is currently under review, is that they would incorporate the section that goes along Kimball Avenue in front of their property. So that would close that gap, and the remaining part only becomes the part that you initially mentioned there of getting across the getting past the Potash Brook and then over to Tech Park.
Paul, isn't
so
there
that's
where
how the rest of that would get closed?
Isn't that where they're putting in the new bridge?
No, the new bridge is where it crosses Muddy Brook at the town line with Williston. Potash Brook is closer to where the Association for the Blind is.
Yes.
It's sort of unless you sort of stop along the road there, you wouldn't necessarily notice that there's a big crossing, but there is one. And then the rest of the projects, we're pretty excited about this year's list, including taking a big stab, as I mentioned, at the Climate Action Plan piece, proposing that to the Regional Planning Commission as a way to look at the transportation side of that, which is a huge portion of all of our community's carbon footprint.
Okay,
when Mary's is going to be opened?
Currently the proposal is that Mary Street would stay closed until Garden Street is open going northbound, so as to not sort of overwhelm that little neighborhood until that, but there's also a legal challenge to that underway, so we shall see.
Paul?
Yeah.
How do we, now we're submitting, are we looking for a certain amount of money from the Chittenden County Regional Planning Commission and then we allocate it? Or do they look at our list and they say, well, we, Chittenden County Regional Planning Commission, like this and this, and we'll fund this and this? How does that occur?
Sure, that's a great question. So on the transportation side, Ted, we're asked to provide them a priority order of what our priorities are. They look at a pool of all of the requests across the county, and you know, if there's more requests than there's money available, they have to start making some tough decisions. And so they will use our priority list to do that. The one caveat to that is that they also need to, all of the proposals need to be able to be qualified under federal transportation funding. And so if we were to submit something that didn't pass muster as far as federal highways goes, then they, mm-hmm. they wouldn't be able to fund it. But we have met with them a week ago, and they didn't, they felt that as long as we're, you know, mindful of, especially on the climate action plan, that this is about transportation and mobility, that they felt that there wasn't anything that jumped off the page to them as being problematic. On the planning side, we last year proposed and were accepted to essentially reserve a chunk of their staff time at a fixed rate that we would pay for. That one is intentionally left flexible so that as the Planning Commission and Council put up their work plans for next year, that we've reserved sort of a block of time to help augment essentially our staffing. So this year, for instance, Taylor Newton is on the phone with us tonight from the Regional Planning Commission. He's helping us with the 500-year floodplain work that we were asking for using that time that we had reserved. So that's really up to us because we're paying for it at a fixed rate.
Mm-hmm.
And that was something that yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
I was just going to say that was something that the that you all sort of challenged staff last year to think about how do we creatively think outside the box and increase our capacity to get projects done. So that was the tool that we used.
Mm-hmm. And again, are they looking at the whole or are they looking specifically at South Burlington? It's sort of ongoing question I've always had. You know, it's good to be part of a community, but you know, we do have some parochial issues here.
There are certain projects which they will fund at 100% that are regional in nature, and those ones tend to get some priority. The biggest project this year is the 89 corridor study, because that affects the entire region. Right. After that, they really have expressed a lot of interest in supporting the local communities and what their transportation issues are. So they look to what our priorities are. That said, if they have $600,000 available and South Burlington asks for $580,000 of that, they might say, you know, we need to spread this around to communities a little more widely. Yep. And then I'll say, that said, the Regional Planning Commission has been pretty supportive of the fact that South Burlington is a, you know, we're in the center of the action. We do have a lot of transportation needs, and so they have been pretty supportive of us tackling the issues that we've flagged.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I don't mean to belay this, but you know, the issue of the obvious number one is, I think, quite a regional issue, more so than the South Burlington issue. We are part of that region, but where the specifics come are encouraging more pedestrian and bikers. People are going to drive. There's still people are going to drive their Beamers from Charlotte to Burlington. They're not going to stop doing that. It's going to be a long time in hell before we can stop traffic like that. So, but we can, you know, get a good bang for the dollar of maybe having several hundred people bike to work that they can't now because they don't feel safe. So that's sort of my shtick, is really trying to narrow it down to really what we can do or South Burlington.
Yeah, I think, you know, the Regional Planning Commission is doing work at the regional level on these subjects, and this is really about what can we do at the local level. To some extent, they interplay with one another. I mentioned to council last night that we don't have any park and rides in Chittenden County, in South Burlington. That might be used by people from a number of places, but it is specifically also a solution at our level. Mm-hmm. And some of the things that we may come up with maybe become models for other communities about, you know, how do we make it easier and more frequent that condominiums get electric vehicle charging in within them? And maybe we solve that locally, and then maybe other communities follow our lead. But your point is taken, and I think the Energy Committee is very strongly on board with solutions that really tackle South Burlington's issues and really, you know, nobody wants this to be a plan that's just sitting on a shelf as some concept for the future.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other thoughts on the priority list or projects that might be missing or aren't appropriate? Paul, anything from the public on this list?
Only the one thing that I mentioned about Kimball Avenue. Beyond that, we've not received anything. And so if commissioners were willing to make a motion to make a recommendation to council, then we'll get that going to them.
Monica?
One question, Paul.
Can you go back to number four for a second? There was something. Yeah. Just along with signs again, I do think that there, if it fits here, I feel strongly that the nature crossing signs throughout Vermont should be integrated more. And I don't know if this is an tying it in with number four somehow, but I do feel that there should be a regional policy on that, because it also, not only does it protect wildlife crossings, but it reminds us all what we're surrounded by. And I think it would slow down traffic too.
Yeah.
So I think it plays multiple roles and does create safer driving environments, period. If that can be worked in somewhere, I'm always pushing for that.
I guess what I would suggest to that one, Monica, is I'm happy to bring that to the regional planning groups and the regional transportation groups. I don't think it needs to be a project in this category, because stop signs have a legal test that needs to be met in order to put them in, whereas something like wildlife crossing one is advisory. And so while it may be excellent policy that changes travel behaviors, it doesn't need a legal foundation to it. It just needs to be a policy decision made.
Okay, anyone else, or are we ready to make the motion?
Has the motion been made?
No.
Well, I'll make that motion to the commission recommends that list of projects to the city council.
Including the Kimball Avenue one, Michael?
Yes.
Great.
Second.
Great. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Michael, did you aye? I think I saw everyone else. Okay, that was unanimous. Aye. Thumbs or voice. So, very good. Thank you, everyone. And Paul, that was a great list. So moving on to the Swift Spear Intersection Scoping Study. So this is actually a perfect item to follow up with that on. This is one of the projects from last year's list.
Yep. So this will be studying how to improve the functionality of that intersection for all users. And per our relatively new policy, we're assigning a host committee. In this case, we really felt strongly that it should be the Planning Commission, because it's a lot of different subject areas. And as a result, the commission is invited to appoint a member to serve on the project team if you'd like to help foster continuity between the policymakers and staff. So it would be probably 4 to 5 meetings, probably daytime over the course of 8 months or so.
Are you looking for volunteers or?
Yes.
Are you looking for volunteers who know something about traffic management or just users of these intersections?
I'll leave that to the commission to decide.
Yeah, I guess my perspective is that we, you know, there's a consultant involved and Public Works that are really like experts in traffic management. But I think what we're bringing to the table is also the other pieces of it, like walkers and bikers and our knowledge of land use in the area. And so I don't think it necessarily needs to be someone who has a background in traffic or transportation to be our volunteer.
Might I suggest maybe, Jessica, if you would you be willing to you know, make a decision of the group here, and in your best judgment, figure out who might be appropriate? Is that asking too much?
Well, I don't like to put anybody on the spot.
No, I'm just saying that, you know, no, not right now, but I mean, maybe deliberate and at some point make a decision.
Yeah. Paul, do we need a decision tonight or appointed by the group?
No, I think as long as it's done by the end of the calendar year, that's fine with me.
Okay.
Michael?
Is there somebody that commissioners can talk to about how this project will function?
I'm probably your best person to do that, Michael. Myself and Justin will be the staff people to it. So okay. I'm happy to serve in that role.
All right. Okay.
How much is the pay?
Good question.
You get a free vaccine.
Yeah. Are there multiple people here interested in participating in that?
I might be interested.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting project and it's in my backyard. So I use that intersection, as do you, Monica, every day, and sometimes several times.
Duncan, are you? You're on. Duncan, you're on mute.
We can't hear you,
Duncan.
Duncan.
But Duncan's on that intersection every day too. So.
You hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I go through that intersection probably 4 times a day.
Yeah, I guess.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, and I guess that's why I thought, like, some people may be more interested than others. You know, I think Bernie probably has the strongest background in transportation and the specific subject area, but he's not as much of a user necessarily compared to some of you that would go a little closer.
So it's, yeah, I seldom go through that intersection, maybe once every week or two. Right. More often when we were actually working from offices, but working from home, I don't go that way very often at all. And during the day would be difficult for me as well. So if there's somebody that uses it regularly and is interested, I would advocate for that person.
I mean, yeah, I mean, it's an interesting project to, I'm interested in, you know, comparing signalized intersections, non-signalized roundabouts, all these things that one experiences it, not necessarily around here, but in other parts of the world, certainly I have. So, you know, it's an interesting project from that point of view.
I would withdraw my name from nomination.
Okay, Ted's withdrawing, but, you know, Duncan, you do use that quite a bit. And so, I mean, if you are also interested, I think we could.
I bike it a lot, but not drive it.
I'd like to talk to Paul and Justin before I make any decision for myself.
Okay. So Michael's
I'm happy to, like I said, I go through it both on my bike and on my car, so I'm familiar with both aspects of how it does and doesn't work.
Yeah, I guess if it, from my perspective, if it is the three of you that are all interested and you all use it a lot, I guess I would probably recommend Duncan, just in that Monica and Michael, you've both been on a lot of other committees for us, so, and continue to be, so that would be my initial thought, if it would work for you, Duncan, and you're interested. And
yeah, I'm interested, but if somebody else is burning to do it, then that's fine. But no, I'm happy to do it. Yeah.
I nominate Duncan.
Would that be okay with you too, Monica?
Oh yeah, sure. No, absolutely. I mean, if the meetings are daytimes and that becomes an issue, I'm flexible, but absolutely, because yeah, I am involved with other things. So absolutely, either way, whatever's helpful.
Great. Okay. Well, we'll go with Duncan if it works for him, and if not, then we'll reevaluate. Does that?
Great. Yeah.
Great.
Thank you, everyone. And
One last question on this particular item: do you know whether this project team will have on its as members lay people who might have an interest in, other than the ones that we, among us, we use it a lot, but there are a lot of people in the golf course estates and the village of Dorset Park and Indian Creek and a few other, Heatherfield around here. I'm sure they would all be interested, so it might.
Yeah, Michael, so the objective for the project team is to sort of provide direct guidance to the consultant as they make their way through the analysis. However, the project also has a robust public participation proposal with it. And what we're looking at in this one is one, sort of recognizing the changed landscape that exists around us right now, one that uses online feedback, forums, gathering input from all the folks that you just said, as well as the Planning Commission would be the host of at least one public meeting to gather feedback and that kind of thing. So that's the way in which we would reach the larger community. And I'd be happy to give the commission a briefing once we've got the scope finalized. We're getting close with that.
So we have a comment in the chat on this topic. Sandy Dooley says, several years ago when this intersection was reconsidered, the consultant strongly recommended that it be reconfigured to a roundabout, citing that in New York State, no municipality could reconfigure an intersection other than as a roundabout unless it provided a written justification for it. So she's suggesting to just please make sure that a roundabout is part of that discussion when it's reconfigured. So I guess moving on to the next item, Monica had brought this up at our last meeting under just announcements. So just a short discussion on outreach, considering that the other paper is no longer providing the detailed coverage of our meetings that they had been in the past. As I suggested I would, I did reach out to Helen, the city council chair, just to see what her thoughts were, because they've, as a council, have an article that they publish in the other paper. And that was one of the things that Monica said the editor was willing to work with us on, potentially publishing things if we provide it to them. So Helen said that she thought it would be a good idea to offer at least a monthly update on things we've been working on. And, since it would likely be one of us, maybe on a rotating basis, writing something, that, there is the challenge to making the updates be more of a consensus view rather than like a minority view if we have kind of differing opinions on things. So I guess that's something that maybe we would need to address like on an ongoing basis, like if someone was going to volunteer to write about an issue, just to kind of write about something broadly. But otherwise she seems supportive of an idea like that. So I don't know if others have kind of thought about and outreach or the other paper, or Paul, if you have some ideas.
Well, certainly Front Porch Forum gets a fair amount of looks. I don't know how how one goes about doing that, whether it's, you know, has to be someone, a point person, but that gets distributed and it's a freebie.
So, we had a minimum for the Front Porch Forum, either, you know, a lot of times you see where there's a very brief one or two sentence things with a link. And so I'm wondering if at a minimum we could say, you know, something along the lines of, you know, the Planning Commission met on, you know, December 8th, and, you know, here's a link to their minutes, or, you know, just, you know, something brief that would at least, you know, get it out there for people that if they're interested in seeing more, that they could click on the link. And that might be a you know, a relatively simple way to at least provide people with another opportunity to, you know, look at the agenda or look at the minutes or whatever, in a brief kind of way.
Right, they can get the audio as well. A link to the audio.
Sure.
Monica?
Yeah, I mean, I just think overall meeting minutes and listening to the meetings is not going to happen with the public. But Paul, you said something about you were going to be writing something for the city's newsletter. Are you doing that regularly, or what are you doing?
We are putting that out bi-weekly, essentially. And all department heads have been asked to be consistent and provide regular pieces as there's something to say. And so, you know, I'm more than happy to do that. And I think if there are topic suggestions that commissioners think that we should be sort of focusing on at a given time, I'm more than happy to get feedback on that and say, you know, hey, it feels like the right time to ask for input on blank subject. You know, I will certainly be covering a variety of issues regardless, but I think that might be a way to also interact with commissioners and get some feedback from you of saying, hey, you know, it feels like this is the right time to let people know about this thing, or, you know, in a month we're going to be talking about accessory apartments, and we'd like to let people know about that kind of thing. So we can reserve a little time under other business on a regular basis to say, you know, what hot topics do you think we should be covering?
So to Bernie's point about the Front Porch Forum quick links, I think that is where, for Front Porch Forum, directing people to that would be fantastic, because I think it'll be more, you know, someone can read it and really understand in one sitting. But I don't know that the other paper would be willing to accept that. They probably want their own content. So I think for all kinds of social media outreach, and there's more that we can do, we can put it on the Facebook groups and all of that too. But so that would be, I think that's fantastic if you have the time and you're willing to do that. And maybe once those are done monthly, it's summarizing that information to put into the other paper, which somebody can.
Well, and you all can decide if you want to be sharing sort of commissioners' perspectives on things also, as Jessica had highlighted, you know, as the policymakers yourselves, so.
Right, if we want to commit to like a monthly rotating authorship, which would mean that each of us would do approximately two per year. If we did something like that, like made an arrangement with the other paper in that format. I mean, I would be willing to do that. I don't think I want to do a monthly thing just for myself. But if we were going to kind of share that across us, I think that could be good. Mm-hmm. And just some notes on the Front Porch Forum. Ray Gonda said that he got information from Michael Woods Lewis And Front Porch Forum has a 97% penetration rate of South Burlington households with internet. So, I mean, that sounds like quite a good tool. I didn't realize so many people did receive that. So.
Oh, and city staff can access all the four.
Yeah, all nine. Yes. I think there's nine sections in South Burlington.
So yes, we do have access to all of them and a certain number of total posts per month per staff person. So if they're coordinated and thoughtful, I can get out sort of semi-regular things. Mm-hmm.
And maybe then it's even for the other paper, like a quarterly summary of what was accomplished. You know, were there any LDRs that were changed? And, you know, a brief summary of why, and then what other issues the public have brought to the commission to, you know, just something on a quarterly basis that just summarizes. But I mean, personally, I wouldn't be interested so much in writing anything about my own opinion, because especially with Planning Commission, I really try to keep it to us as a group.
Right.
So it feels like any one of us kind of talking about our own opinion it just kind of goes against what we try to do.
I guess that was my thought. And I, you know, I brought it up because it seemed like that was an idea that was brought up. I know the counselors have that situation with the other paper, but to me, it seems almost a little more like what you're saying, quarterly or topic based, like we had talked about maybe in, depending how this next agenda item goes, but, you know, maybe in January, having a draft of the chapter 10 and 12 items ready for public comment. Maybe that's when we like publish a map and like a summary of what the changes are and say, this is out for public review. This is a big change. Take a look at the website for more information. Like maybe that's really what we want to do when there's like something we really want feedback on, put in a targeted article at that point.
Yeah, I agree with that, Jessica, especially getting things out to people in advance. You know, one of the complaints I hear regularly is, well, I didn't know about this, and now you're doing the final hearing to, you know, to approve it, and, you know, you never got public input. And, you know, so I think anything that we can do to help people know about things in advance where they have time to provide comment, you know, before it gets to the city council is to everybody's benefit.
How, Paul, how far out in advance do we set our public hearing dates? There's a requirement for that, right?
Yeah, we have to announce, they have to be published in the paper 15 days in advance, which really means that we send it to the other paper almost 3 weeks in advance.
So if we, every time, anytime we have a public hearing for sure, and we would just have to meet, like kind of giving people a heads up about what it will be about. And then we know that we'd need to, is it Thursdays? I would imagine we'll have to see what the editor is willing to do. But, you know, if we at least make that a policy, and then maybe we just discuss for the given content who might want to take on explaining what the public meeting is about. So that seems like a great one. And then I think as we're finishing inclusionary zoning, I like what you were suggesting, Jessica, for this. And then also when we get closer with the PUDs, like putting some of those graphics in, I think that could be really beneficial, even if it's not tied to a specific public hearing, but they might be because of how we're going.
One suggestion for you to think about also is I think that your idea of focusing on being informative as from the group is a really good one. I would add to it that one thing, especially with the other paper that you all can add uniquely, is that you are all volunteers and residents in the city, and that coming from the perspective of, you know, this is your community, that here are your thoughts and what are all of your fellow residents thinking about, as opposed to something that's a little more formal as written of, you know, that staff might write that sort of says, public hearing is on this date. Here are the six items under consideration. You can speak to it a little bit more from the, you know, here are the six items we're presenting that we'd really love to get feedback on to sort of draw a closer connection back to the community on it. So just a thought.
But Paul, can you always help us polish them? Are you willing?
Is anybody help a good in any way?
Because I'm comfortable drafting things and presenting things, but I would feel like I'd really want someone else, you know, and others may feel the same, you know, you set out a draft and at least get somebody else's help in bringing it to a finesse it to.
Always a, happy to help. I almost went into journalism instead of planning.
Oh, that's exciting news.
Oh.
we got another public comment that one of the advantages of public Front Porch Forum is that they're often posted the same or the next day.
Right.
Around elections. Sorry, Ray, I'm paraphrasing there. But you can see the full comment there in the chat always. So so I think was that enough to go on?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
What's our next step? Like what have we decided and what will we do first or next?
I think as we have something that we want comment on, or we think there's kind of a bigger, newer topic, we'll do those things. Front Porch Forum and other paper article.
Were we going to commit to doing something quarterly in the other paper? I mean, I think at a minimum, it would be good to have that.
Should we try to target a January for what were this articles 10 and 12, like you said?
I think that sounds like a good first step.
So Monica, might I suggest that if you'd be willing to reach out, I think you said that you were the one who'd communicated with the editor before of just floating that idea past them?
Yes. I'm sorry. Yes, I did. But what was your question? Should it be me?
Just the idea of floating a quarterly thing that might start at late January?
I think it should be Jessica who asks her. I called as a community member who happened to be on the Planning Commission. I think she would appreciate.
Yeah, I can do
share, okay. You know.
Okay, I will do that. Okay, then moving on, I think then we're back up to agenda item 4, which is the amendments to the land development regulations, starting with the floodplain items, which are mostly in chapter 10.
So I'm very happy to welcome Taylor Newton to join us. Taylor is a staff member at the Regional Planning Commission and a certified floodplain manager, and was very happy to help us out to get to the point of delivering a product based on what you had asked for. I'd taken a very first crack, and I think I told you that I shared a draft with him the same time I shared with you, and I asked him to come to this meeting so that he can talk directly with you about some of these amendments and answer your questions from a perspective of somebody who's an expert in the field. So thanks for coming, Taylor.
Thanks, Paul. Hi, folks. Thanks for having me. I just joined CCRPC in February, but before that I did work as a senior planner at Northwest Regional Planning Commission in St. Albans. And before that as a zoning administrator and town planner in Milton, Vermont for a few years. So I've got a bit of experience both writing and administering floodplain regulations. And I'm happy to review this draft with you tonight. Paul, does it make sense to screen share the draft itself, or would you like me to just kind of talk through the overarching changes? Perhaps Paul has stepped away from the computer real quick. So,
Sorry, Taylor. Taylor, I'm happy to either share it or to give control over to you if you want to share a draft that you've got so you can walk it through it at your own pace.
Yeah, sure. Share draft if you could. Or sorry, allow me to share, please. And I can and I can drive the ship.
All right. Coming your way.
Great. There we go. I'm going to do this while... Can you just see my Word document or can you see my notes below it? I'm going to...
We also see your notes.
You also see my notes. So does this work for people that I can kind of see my notes as I share? Or Paul, does it make more sense for you to share and I have my notes in front of me?
I don't know about you guys, but I have... I have myself on an iPad and I have the documents on my computer here. So for me, it works either way.
You were fine with this way, Taylor.
Great. I appreciate it. I am much more used to Zoom where you can only see one of my applications at a time. So I see that GoToMeeting's a little bit different. So overall, I just want to highlight a few of the overarching themes. One, Paul notes here in the highlighted text, we're essentially doing a replacement of your existing section 10.01. That was done not because the draft is substantially different. It's just because with the track changes and the reorganization of the material, it was very hard to track and to see what was actually changing. So we felt like just starting over with a new section was easier. The other big change, or one of the big changes, is instead of having all land development in your 100-year floodplain or in your floodplain overlay district receive or require conditional use review, we're now going to call it floodplain review. We're going to detach this review from the conditional use standards that regulate the rest of the bylaw, and we're going to create this different type of review, floodplain review, that really focuses on the specific standards that the federal government requires through the National Flood Insurance Program.
So quick question, would you still do a conditional use review on other elements other than the floodplain stuff then?
That's a good question. So yes. So essentially what we're talking about here is an overlay district. So you know, an extra set of rules on top of those base districts. So, you know, if we're in your ag rural district, you know, all the rules that apply to the land uses, either, you know, permitted or conditional in that ag rural district, are going to apply regardless. And these rules in this section, this overlay district, are just rules on top. Does that make sense? Okay. Other large overarching changes is the addition of regulating your 500-year floodplain. I think it's a really, really great idea that you guys are thinking ahead. And as directed by Paul, we've divided that 500-year floodplain into a B1 and a B2 district. The B1 district being those areas where you want to allow some infill development, namely north of the airport. And then the B2 district being those areas of the 500-year floodplain that essentially are undeveloped that you would like to keep undeveloped. So any questions on those overarching themes? I can't see all your faces at the same time, so please speak up if you do have any questions.
I have a question in B1. That means new development or expanding existing development?
In B1, you could do both.
Okay.
Okay.
But new development subject to the new rules.
Yes, both new development and any additions, any changes to existing land development in those areas would have to meet the new rules. There are some interesting rules in terms of what substantial improvement and substantial damage and what that means. And what that requires of the landowner if redevelopment does happen, and we can talk about that a little further along if you'd like. All right, I'm gonna first start here and in the administration section, subsection D. It is here that we define the B1, the B2 districts. I'm gonna highlight it here on my screen. This is for a question for the commission and for Paul. You know, the description here of that B1 and the B2 zone, is that sufficient or should we be a little bit more specific in terms of how we're describing those two zones?
I think the description meets our goals that we described as a group over the last couple meetings, but I don't know if where we need to refer to the map on that. Like, do we need?
Yeah, that was my only note, is that we do need to reference that it's shown on map XXX. Okay. So just highlight that for when we reach, yep, that point.
Great.
Especially because we're the B1 and the B2 are entirely a local designation. Mm-hmm. So that's the only place that somebody would be able to find that is through our own mapping in South Burlington.
Okay. A little further down in the administration section. Go ahead.
I know you covered that uncertainty in item 2B. I think if it's uncertain, the applicant can appeal to the administrative officer.
Correct.
And then,
yeah,
he would have to have.
Okay. Yeah. So, you know, typically with your one-year floodplain, you know, if an applicant disagrees, the applicant can go get a LOMA, a letter of map amendment from FEMA. That's a determination by FEMA about whether or not, well, essentially stating that the property is outside the floodplain. FEMA doesn't do LOMAs for a 500-year floodplain. So, you know, we felt like the easiest approach here would just be to treat the interpretation of the 500-year floodplain like any ZA decision and just have that decision be appealed to the ERB.
I had a question about that one, if you can just stay there for a minute. And it actually doesn't pertain to the floodplains, but whoa, if you can go back to that 2B though. The language is very clear here, and this is really more for Article 12. I would imagine that some landowners may disagree with, you know, for example, some of our habitat block, and the language that's used here, you know, if an applicant disagrees, is so clearly written that I wonder if there isn't, we can't create something like that in Article 12. As well. So just if we can just keep that in mind, I'll refer back to that. Thanks.
No problem. And I guess while we're talking about Article 12 too, you know, Paul has asked me to take a look at Article 12 a little bit later this month, just to provide some general feedback. And I'll be sure to keep your comment in mind while I review that article.
Thank you.
The other large change or addition to this administration subsection is we've specifically outlined what types of development are exempted within the floodplain in terms of receiving a permit. This list of exempted development is from the state model bylaw, so it can be altered and changed. Anyone looking at this list see anything that should not be exempted or have any questions about how that exactly works?
Quick question for you on that. Just, and this is an aside, the interior improvements to existing buildings that cost less than 500.
Yeah.
Where was that? That seems kind of a smaller designation. I just wondered. I mean, it's an interior renovation.
Paul asked the same question, and it's a very good question. So first off, it's important to understand that to be a member of a national flood insurance program, technically South Burlington has to issue permits for any interior improvements that occur within any structures within the district, and that's very much, you know, different than how zoning typically operates in municipalities. So just know that in general, that you know, if a structure is in the floodplain and they're doing a kitchen remodel, they technically need a zoning permit, because that kitchen remodel is going to be more than $500 likely. The $500 limit is super low. We asked Vermont Agency of Natural Resources if South Burlington could move that to $5,000 or a higher amount that would be more typical of a remodel, and their answer was no. That even this $500 amount was essentially negotiated with FEMA as something that was, you know, de minimis, that very minor, and that FEMA is strict in you know, finding that you know, all interior improvements really need a permit if we're following, you know, the Code of Federal Regulations to a T.
Hey Taylor, this is Paul. A question for you. As it relates to the 500-year floodplain, mm-hmm. as that's not a FEMA, could the Planning Commission set its own number there?
Yes.
So, for example, we have a standard citywide that if you're doing $5,000 in interior renovations, that requires a permit. If the commission wanted to, under letter D, could it say interior improvements to existing buildings costing less than $500 within the 100-year floodplain and less than $5,000 within the 500-year floodplain?
Yes, we can do that. Would that be something that the Planning Commission would want to do?
Seems to make more sense. Yeah,
I'm seeing some nods, some shaking the heads. Okay,
I think that would alleviate some annoyances in places like the Ethan Allen Industrial Park, or if somebody happens to have a house that's on the edge of the 500-year floodplain.
Well, and some of those businesses also, like I'm just thinking of Kitchen World, for example. I mean, they might frequently redesign their showroom, you know, as part of their business.
I mean, as a practical matter, $5,000 in and of itself is a minuscule number. So, you know, usually what we're seeing is something closer to $50,000 or $100,000. So this will just sort of alleviate some heartache for some really tiny little, you know, a plumber comes in to do something.
Yeah, I can certainly make that change and do $5,000 to the 500-year floodplain, because that is solely under your jurisdiction. It's not under the jurisdiction of the NFIP. No other real big changes in the administration subsection, so I'm going to move on to the application requirements. Generally, in this section, we were really focused on providing clarity about what an applicant has to submit. You know, before it was pretty much like submit a conditional use application and some general information about elevation, but we wanted to be more specific here. And so we've asked the applicants to submit a floodplain development plan. We purposely used that term instead of site plan, not to confuse what was being asked for with site plan review. So we've used this different term, and hopefully here underneath subsection E1A, we've done a sufficient enough job describing what needs to be submitted. I do want to note too that requiring a project review sheet is also, you know, not typical for municipal zoning, but is strongly advised by the state model bylaw. When regulating the floodplain itself, the NFIP requires that the municipality essentially be the entity that makes sure that the applicant is receiving all their state and federal permits. And the local permit goes last. That's the opposite of how we do local zoning in Vermont otherwise. So the project review sheet helps the zoning administrator understand what state and federal permits may be required, and allows them to carry out that task. I do have one error to note that I made. With an application where we do ask that the applicant submit information about base flood elevation. So that's essentially the height of the flood level, if you will, that you're regulating within the 100-year floodplain. That isn't going to work necessarily for your 500-year floodplain. It will only work for those parts of the 500-year floodplain that are on reaches or next to the Winooski River. That's because those areas of the 500-year floodplain in South Burlington are the only areas that have an established base flood elevation. All other areas of the 500-year floodplain in South Burlington do not have a base flood elevation established, either on the actual FEMA maps or in the FIS, the flood insurance study that accompany the maps. And so what we'll ask for instead, what I will add here, is essentially an ask that the applicant provide information about average grade. Overall, we'll see in the standard section that, you know, what we've said is that in the 500-year floodplain, the applicants will be required to build at least 2 feet above grade, average grade. And that'll be different than how we're regulating in the 100-year floodplain, which is essentially 2 feet above base flood elevation. And again, that's because there is no base flood elevations in much of your 500-year floodplain. Have I confused you at all on that point? Does that make sense?
Yeah, and we had given a preview of that issue at a previous meeting, so.
Okay, great. And I, you know, Jessica did remind me too that you know, we should regulate those areas of the 500-year floodplain next to the Winooski River using the base flood elevation. So I'll make that change as well and clarify that there will be that difference in how we regulate 500-year floodplain between those with the base flood elevation and those that don't.
That will be added to the later draft it's not in what we're seeing right now, but will be added to.
Okay, that is correct, thanks. Monica. I'm going to try to add that later this week or the very early next week. The last addition to the application section is this waiver section. This is not required, but it does provide the applicant an ability to ask the DRB to waive one of the application requirements. I just wanted to note that because it is not required.
And just for context, that's fairly common in our regulations, and it's really just used for common sense things. You know, we hate asking an applicant to provide something that's just irrelevant to the application. And that's really the only place where something like that gets used, is if it's just completely irrelevant to the specific thing that they're applying for.
That makes sense.
Is that clear in that statement, though? Because that seemed like a pretty broad statement. I'm just looking at it.
I feel pretty good about that, Monica. It says when it's not needed to comply with the regulations.
And Monica, I'll just add the other reason why I'm okay with this as drafted is actually because of this language below about the process and about referrals here to the NFIP coordinator. So, you know, instead of the DRB, you know, making a decision on their own with no support about whether or not to waive an application requirement, because this referral has to happen to the state NFIP coordinator, the DRB can ask advice from the NFIP coordinator about, you know, what application requirements, you know, could safely be waived and what shouldn't be waived.
So wouldn't that waiver part be better to be lower than after the review process piece, just so that's clear?
I would disagree. Okay. I think in terms of the process of what would happen, the applicant would submit the waiver first, and then the full application, including the waiver, would then be referred to the NFIP coordinator. So it wouldn't be like the NFIP coordinator reviewing an application, then not knowing the waiver request has been submitted, and then they wouldn't know to weigh in on that ask. Does that make sense?
Yep, I defer to you. Yep, makes sense. Thanks.
Okay. Moving on to development review process. These referrals that I was just speaking about to the NFIP coordinator and stream alteration engineer, if there is a stream alteration, this language is pretty much right out of your bylaw now. In terms of process, we have now, you know, allowed some floodplain reviews to be done administratively by the zoning administrator. You know, right now is written, essentially all development in South Burlington that's in this overlay district has to go to the DRB. You know, this allows for some administrative review of some more minor types of land development. The list is here. This list is from the state model bylaw. Does the PC feel confident in this list?
I have a question about stream alteration, which might come into conflict with our environmental protection standards. I'd have to read it carefully, but it seems to me that the alteration of a stream might be something that we wouldn't like in a natural protection zone or resource.
So, Michael, my comment to that would be that, as Taylor was saying, this is an overlay district. And so in order to move forward with something like a stream alteration, they would need to get approval both under the stream alteration section and whatever the standards are in there and this floodplain section. So it's important, I think, that they are, that they, your point of them coordinating is important, but one doesn't over supersede the other.
So they'd have to get this and a habitat disturbance assessment approved, possibly.
At whatever the standards are for adjusting for a stream alteration in Article 12.
Yep, okay.
Thank you, Paula. Yeah, I can't personally speak authoritatively on your Article 12 yet. I'll have more expertise there once I give it a review in a few weeks. But that is a good question, Michael. Thank you. Any other questions on the administrative review that is now allowed? Okay. Hearing none, I am going to keep moving forward. You know, everything that's not in that administrative review list goes to the DRB. After the DRB issues a decision, it's a zoning permit, just like every other type of DRB review. No changes there. Development review standards. So I think the important thing to remember here is that all of these standards below are going to equally apply to your 100-year floodplain and your 500-year floodplain. So just please keep that in mind. And I'm going to bring up one example of basements in a second that I think is worth some thinking about. First off, in this standard section, we've moved prohibited development to the top of the section. My question to the PC is how this is written. Is this clear enough that principal structures aren't allowed in any of these areas except for that B1 district, that infill district within the 500-year floodplain?
Yeah, I think that's good that it's right up front.
Okay, great. Otherwise, the standards themselves are fundamentally the same. You know, one of the big changes is one you've already talked about and approved, and that's the change from requiring new development or substantially improved development to be elevated 2 feet above BFE instead of 1 foot above BFE. We've added some standards for critical facilities in terms of their location. And also added some specific standards for historic structures. So we've got our critical facilities, and then we've got specific standards for historic structures that are a little bit more lenient than the rest of the standards. Again, I already noted the difference between 100-year floodplain and 500-year floodplain in terms of where we're measuring. BFE versus average grade. the one standard that gives me a little bit of hesitation. I don't think it's wrong or bad, but the 100-year floodplain rules require that basements are be essentially prohibited. And so right now, as written, we've brought that right along to the 500-year floodplain too. Is that okay with the PC? Does anyone foresee an issue with that?
No. I have a question about that. If basements were allowed in the 500-year floodplain, mm-hmm. are there things that people could do to make them safer? You know, like if the basement can only go down so far and then have at least a 10-foot ceiling, so the first floor is actually, you know, higher than ground level. Like, are there things that could be done? Because again, thinking about that industrial zone there, or the Ethan Allen Park, I'm sure a lot of storage could be happening below, you know, a retail or commercial space, and they might not mind a few steps up to get in. So I would ask, can a basement be there but have stipulations that make it safer or clear that, you know, they could have lost due to flooding?
Duncan, looks like you have a related question.
Yeah, actually, I was thinking part of the 500-year floodplain goes through Oak Creek and Butler Farms, does it not? So those are houses that existing have basements. If somebody was going to do a significant remodel, I'm assuming, would we be telling them you can't have a basement now? I guess I'm thinking, what about that scenario?
Yeah, let me take Monica's questions first, and then I'll take Duncan's question. Actually, let me take those in reverse now that I think about it. Let me take Duncan's question first. So with a residential structure in the 500-year floodplain, you know, if there is substantial damage, either by fire or by flood, or if that homeowner is doing a substantial improvement by building an addition or a substantial remodel, and everyone's clear about what substantial damage to substantial improvement means?
50%.
No? Yes?
Yeah, let's give us a
50% of the value of the structure.
I'm sorry.
Not the land. 50% of the value of the existing structure. So let's say, you know, $500,000 home. As you know, typically the town uses the assessed value. You know, if you know that addition or that improvement or that damage has a value of over $300,000, over 50% of the value of the $500,000 house, that property owner wouldn't be able to rebuild a basement, and would have to elevate at least 2 feet above grade to the front entrance of their home. So yeah, that's something to consider. With Monica's question, sorry, I'll do Monica's question real quick. With Monica's question, you know, is there something you can do to make basements safer in the 500-year floodplain? I can't authoritatively answer that. I've worked with you know, municipalities that you know, regulate the 100-year floodplain, and FEMA in those circumstances essentially say that any area below BFE really should be used for parking, for storage, or for access. And if there is some enclosed space, there essentially needs to be flood openings or breakaway walls. So, I mean, potentially, yeah, we could write a standard here. They could say you could do basements in the 500-year floodplain, but you've got to have flood openings or you can only use it for storage, and you can't have any mechanical down there. But if we had that route, I certainly would want to call in state NFIP coordinator just to make sure that we're on the right track.
So in a residential unit, then they might have their boiler system in the basement that's mechanical. You're saying that would have to no longer be in a basement?
Yeah, that's it's a big resiliency piece. Like we worked on, our company worked on like an economic study related to floodplains a few years ago. And one of the things that we found was just by having all the utilities raised up above that BFE, communities were able to save huge amounts of money, even if they weren't able to raise the entire floor elevations up. You know, if you think about it, like if your living room gets flooded, yeah, you might have some, a little bit of mold or some carpeting you need to replace or something like that. But if you have your heating system flooded, like that's a really huge cost. So having utilities raised above the BFE, the flood elevation, is even more important, I think, than just the floor itself. Like
I would agree with that.
Yeah, I thought I'd read that you would, that the mechanicals would have to be raised, and that below them, yes, you could have a basement, but it has to be flow through for floodwaters.
Paul?
Is that correct?
So for new development, non-substantial damage, non-substantial improvement, all utilities would have to be elevated above BFE. And that's your current rule, that we're not changing that, except for in the 500-year floodplain. That's new. If we're talking in addition, you know, that's not substantial damage, not substantial improvement, either in the 500-year or the 100-year floodplains, you wouldn't have to elevate your mechanical. Does that make sense?
So a question and a comment for you, Taylor. The question is, let's say in your example of a $500,000 house, if they're doing $300,000, $350,000 worth of renovations, it's only that portion that is in the 500-year floodplain that is relevant, right? So let's say you did, you know, some work on your third story of your house, and that was $100,000 worth. That's not part of that money, right? It's only work in the, like, below grade, or is that part of it also? Just because the house is in
any part of the structure, because the if the structure itself is located within the boundaries.
Got it. Okay.
Hey, Paul, is with the 500-year floodplain, as Duncan had said, Butler Farms. But does it continue on south into, I guess we call it Larkin's property?
No, it ends, it goes about two-thirds of the way south through Butler Farms, but it doesn't reach the, what we call the Marceau Meadows property.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I'm sorry, can you just, slow walk me through this. Let's just say somebody in a neighborhood within the 500 and they do this work, but they don't follow this, they don't change their basement, they leave the mechanicals in there. And then there is a flood. Are they not able to have access to insurance because of that, because they made that change and they didn't? What are the consequences if someone does a renovation and does not move their mechanicals or make that change?
Depends on the sequence of events that happened before the damage. So, I mean, if this person is being a good citizen and getting all their permits, the city ideally catches them before they, they go over substantial improvement and requires them to elevate their mechanical. If they don't do that, a fire or a flood happens, the fire and flood causes substantial damage, it would be at that point in time that the property owner would be required to elevate their mechanical. If substantial damage does not occur in that flood or fire, that property owner, if they're not caught in terms of them having done something without a permit, they would not be required to raise their mechanical. Does that make sense, Monica?
Yeah.
If they did something without getting the required permits, insurance won't cover them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, if the insurance company does catch them, yeah, you're right, Michael.
And what percent of the homes in a neighborhood like that are we talking about, Paul? I mean, people use their basements for far more than storage. Not many?
In terms of what's in the five-year floodplain, I mean, Paul would have a better answer than me, but I don't recall many in terms of dozens upon dozens.
I would say that there's...
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Paul.
I would say that there's probably, I'm looking at a map now. There's some in the Chamberlain neighborhood. I'd say maybe a dozen to 15, something like that. And in the Butler Farms neighborhood, it's not too many. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, maybe another 15-ish. And I think those are the primary areas where it's residential. I'm probably missing a couple. Looks like possibly the neighborhood at the very end of Joy Drive, up behind Rice, where there's townhomes, and a few homes on Brookwood Avenue, sort of right in behind, maybe not even touching, almost touching right behind the Hannafords at the U Mall. So call it 30 to 40 total, maybe.
I guess I have a question about this. Is there a way for us to just have no new basements? Because I get what some commissioners are saying, like if someone had a fire in their home or something, and now they're being told they have to fill in their basement, it's kind of a big deal for an existing home in a neighborhood. But in my opinion, I wouldn't really want a new home to put a basement in these zones, because we just know that we're destined to get larger, bigger storms, and people do put important things to them in their basements, and sometimes humans sleep in basements when they're not supposed to, and it just seems like a risk damage that we don't need to encourage for new structures. So I don't know if there's a way to designate that.
Yeah, because it also will immediately negatively impact current residences' property value, home values. If, like, basically, it just causes, I think, a lot of potential harm to their resale, to their ability. And if it, what, because this is not required, it would be our statutes that make it. We could have some flexibility with that. We could just say if it's a current home that was built before this and it has a basement, then it does not, it would not need to follow. Okay. I don't know. I think for home, for residential homes.
And Monica, your comment about resale being changed, you know, these buildings are already in the 500-year floodplain. It's already on a map as being in that zone. The only change here, is that we are making some rules about it. So I don't know.
Right. It's not that they're in the, but, you know, particularly in some of the older homes, people that are going to be buying them may want to do some significant renovation. Some of the homes are 60 years old. And so but they're told they can't, you know, they can't renovate a significant amount. That I think that will really harm the seller. And I don't know.
So would you folks like me to take a shot at kind of bifurcating the standard here and, you know, having one rule that applies to the 1-year floodplain, clearly, because we have to have that. And then having a different rule apply to the 5-year floodplain, where we would not allow new basements in the B1, but we would allow existing basements to continue existing, even if substantial damage or substantial improvement occurs.
Can I briefly play the devil's advocate on that?
I mean, I get what everybody is saying. But on the other hand, if somebody's going to invest a whole bunch of money in redoing their basement, it would be a shame to then have it flood after that. And I'm wondering if there's maybe some middle ground where, you know, at a minimum, you know, they elevate their, you know, their furnace up above, you know, I know there's some FEMA standards where, you know, you've got to put it on a, you know, a 2 or 3 foot, you know, block above the floor so that it's not right down on the floor, and that, you know, you've got to have a sump pump and, you know, so, you know, some things that would make sense to minimize damage. Because, you know, the whole reason we're doing this, I think, is, you know, with the thought that there's going to be more, potentially more common 500 year floods. And, you know, ultimately we're trying to save people, you know, the cost of having significant damage occur. And so, you know, I guess I'm hesitant to just throw it out without thinking about it a little bit, or without thinking about, are there other mitigation things we can do, like, you know, watertight windows for the basement, you know, elevating the, you know, the furnace, other mitigation numbers.
Sorry, I'm not thinking quite as fast as I should on my feet here, but I think we do actually have the middle ground here you're talking about, Bernie. So this is a standard a little bit further up, and this standard would continue to apply to any improvement in the 500-year floodplain, and would apply to any substantial damage or substantial improvement in the 500-year floodplain or any new construction. And that standard is that the construction occur with the electrical, heating, ventilation, plumbing, and air conditioning equipment and other service facilities be designed or located as to prevent water from entering and accumulating. You know, I think by the edit I had previously mentioned in terms of allowing those basements to continue to exist, this standard would still apply in that, you know, that mechanical essentially would have to be elevated. So I think we are at that middle ground you're talking about.
And keep in mind also, Bernie, with regard to insurance, you know, people have to have flood insurance if they're in a zone like that. So the issue with regard to the damage, presumably, if they do have a mortgage, they have insurance for it.
Ted,
well, that's true, but the insurance company may ask, you know, you put all this money in to redo it, and, you know, why didn't you do this stuff? But if that language is in there that they have to take mitigation measures, uh-huh, can't talk tonight, mitigation measures, then I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
But again, that means they want to do a kitchen renovation, and they're going to have to add on top of that kitchen renovation expense changing the location of their boiler, change and all the pipes that go along with that, and the, I mean, that's not a small, it's not a small task. And I guess where is it the job of the homeowner to, and the insurance company for that matter, to say, hey, you know, this is what we want. If you want to be insured, you need to do this. Is it a regulation that we need to have in place? You know, is it?
So I have another question to add on to that too, and that's, you know, my understanding, and I'm not an insurance person, but my understanding is that, you know, if you own the property or a structure in the 100-year floodplain, you are required by your bank to have flood insurance. But my understanding is that in the 500-year floodplain, that's not necessarily the case. I think it's something to consider, and perhaps someone else knows more about that, but that's my understanding of how that works.
I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of these folks that are in the 500-year floodplain in some of these residential neighborhoods may not even have an idea that they are in a floodplain. I don't know if there's any way to verify that or not. I hear what you're saying, Bernie, but I kind of agree with Monica. I'm a little concerned about somebody just suddenly getting whacked with something like this and having no idea that it was coming down the pike.
Would it help folks to know how many flood insurance claims have happened historically in South Burlington? I understand that there is a little legitimate concern that Monica and Duncan are raising, but perhaps if we could provide some context about how many claims have happened historically, we can get a better sense for how much of a worry this should or shouldn't be. Would that help?
No, not in my opinion. Okay. Because, yeah. And the only reason I say that, I would say that if we were in some of the communities that have had some large floods, but we have been miraculously spared from really giant floods for many decades now here in South Burlington. Like Irene missed us.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And, you know, I know it's based on probability, but, you know, it's been a long time since we've had a big flood here in South Burlington. And I don't want to say we're due, but I don't know that, you know, looking at the last couple of decades really shows us what might happen in the near future. And, you know, I think the idea here, Monica and others, is to help guide these landowners so that they avoid a catastrophic damage, because we know there's a risk to being in these locations, and it's just a matter of like when that damage happens, or and you know, if we can guide them while they're spending money to spend it in a way that is protecting themselves from damage, just feels like a good idea.
I think there's also protection of the neighborhood. You know, you're talking about potentially hazardous waste oozing, you know, throughout the community. So, you know, it's not only the existing homeowner, but it's the neighborhood.
I mean, I think the other side of that is, though we know that 500 is going to happen more frequently than 500, we're placing a serious burden potentially on those homeowners for something that may not happen that frequently. And if they try to, you know, just for the current dwellings, if they try to, you know, to make a renovation or sell for something that, absolutely for new, and absolutely, you know, providing somewhere, and I'm not sure that it's a regulation responsibility, but providing, you know, what you should do to protect yourself. I mean, you're going to be out money, and to Ted's point, you're going to potentially environmentally harm your neighbors. But for a 500 year plane, for a current, and we're talking about maybe 30 homes in town, it means a lot to those 30 people, but it's not, we're not talking half the city. It seems like a lot of pain, a large burden put on a very small number of households. And this again is going to be the largest asset these people have. So I'm weary of that.
Can we, I hear what you're saying, Monica, and it makes some sense that if somebody's going to renovate, you know, their upstairs bedroom or their kitchen, that to have to put money into their basement, you know, is an extra expense that they may not necessarily need to do. Under the 500 year, can we, you know, maybe change the language a little bit where it says that, you know, if you're going to renovate your basement, you have to do these things. Because I agree, if they're redoing a second floor bedroom, to have them have to, you know, raise their furnace and put in, you know, watertight windows and all that for their basement, it doesn't pass the straight face test, for lack of a better term. But, you know, clearly if they were gonna change their basement from an unfinished basement to a finished basement, it would make a heck of a lot of sense to have to do all this stuff. So is there a way that maybe we can tweak the language that if you're going to spend more than X dollars renovating your basement, that you got to do all this stuff?
Yes.
For the 500 year?
I don't know what that looks like, but Bernie, I think I can try to make something like that work. Yeah.
But I don't think it should just be the basement. I think it should be anything within that 2 feet of the adjacent grade, because say you do redo your entire first floor, and now you've spent, so you have a $200,000 house, and you spend $100,000 redoing your whole first floor, it feels like that should be raised above the base elevation.
Above that 2 feet above grade. Yep.
But then you have to remove your second floor. I mean, that's, I know that they should have to do that, but that may just simply not be a financial option. And so they therefore just won't. And then that will harm the seller's ability to ever, you know, that, I mean, that.
Taylor, can I ask you a quick question? Yeah. It's just a logistical question. When you're talking about raising the base of the furnace or something, you're talking about taking it out of the basement. It would have to come out of the basement and be placed 2 feet above grade.
So yeah, it would come out of the basement. And then essentially, yeah, because of our 2 feet above grade requirement, and this standard here that residential structures to be substantially improved. Let me take a step back. So I think it's important to understand that what we're saying here, before we even talk about utilities, let's understand what we're saying here about structures. Here we're saying that structures that are substantially improved that exist in that 5-year floodplain. So for instance, you know, that ranch in the Chamberlain neighborhood that's in the 5-year floodplain, if they substantially improve or have substantial damage, they have to raise the structure. It's not just the utilities. They have to raise the whole structure 2 feet above grade. And by raise the structure, I mean the entrance to the front door. It's essentially the lowage average grade. So they not only would have to raise the utilities, they would have to physically jack up the structure 2 feet. That's what we're talking about. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and that's where I think the cost burden is so great. It just won't make sense, and so that won't happen, and it deteriorates the asset. The money that somebody would have to put into doing that in order to redo a kitchen, it just seems like it's an unfair burden. And yes, they should know the risks. Absolutely, anyone buying the house should know the risks. If in the long term, you know, maybe if they were going to take a one level ranch and convert it into a 3-story home, okay, then yeah, that, and it's going to house more people, or it's going to turn into a 2-family because we change zoning or something, I don't know. But then yeah, that gets into a bigger issue. But if it remains basically its unit size and they're just trying to do this upgrade, maybe it's tied to that. Because if it's just that going to remain that size a unit, the cost to raise the entire house will just make it an impossible scenario for someone. But if they were going to add a second and third floor, and like I said, turn it into a 2-family or whatever, make it a McMansion, then yeah, when you're adding all of that space, maybe then it becomes a requirement. I don't know, something, but the cost has to, yeah.
I want to be cognizant of everyone's time, and I want to respond to, sorry, real quick, Ted. I think a couple of things, you know, even if we're talking about that small ranch in Chamberlain neighborhood, $200,000 house, you know, we're talking about over $100,000 of improvement. You know, a kitchen you can do for cheaper than that, I hope, but I do hear you, Monica. And the other thing I want to mention is that substantial improvement number. Some communities choose to track essentially 3-year increments. So they'll say they'll track the amount of improvements kind of on a rolling 3-year cycle. So you could kind of do substantial, you could do some improvements over time that would never trigger. So, you know, you could do $90,000 of improvements to keep you below that threshold, wait 3 or 5 more years and do more improvements, so you always remain below the threshold. So I don't know if you want to build in that ability for property owners to do that, and I would want to look at your existing definition of substantial improvement, but you know, I think for most renovations, unless you're doing what you're talking about, Monica, adding a second story, adding another unit, you know, I don't think that this elevation requirement would be triggered.
I guess I don't understand why this triggers one's necessity to retrofit the basement. So one neighbor doesn't do anything with his house, and it's at risk, let's say, at risk to the neighborhood if there's a flood. But then the other neighbor who's making some retro, you know, alterations has to spend all this money. So it's, why does it even trigger?
Frankly, it's because we're essentially adapting, you know, these rules that apply to 1-year floodplain, and we're just kind of sticking them on top of the 5-year floodplain.
But you might as well say to the 15 people in Butler's Farms, you're required to retrofit your basement because you're at risk to the neighborhood.
Well, Ted, I think that, and Taylor, correct me if I'm wrong, but Ted, I think that the answer to that question sort of lies in the original purpose of what floodplain districts are supposed to do, which is to minimize the loss of property value. So if you're making a major investment in the property, therefore increasing the value of your property, therefore you're placing more value at risk. Is that sort of the idea, Taylor, that that's where this sort of germinates from? It's really about,
yes,
you know, how much payouts are going to need to be in the future.
But the owner is bearing the risk, not the neighborhood or the community.
I would kind of disagree with that because the NFIP operates in such a way that the property owner is never paying true actuarial rate, and that the, you know, the National Flood Insurance Program is highly subsidized. So a lot of the risk, or a lot of, you know, the payout that will happen to that property or to replace the infrastructure is really borne by the taxpayers, and not by the property owner themselves.
But the 500-year people aren't qualifying for that flood insurance, I thought you said.
They are not required necessarily by their mortgage company, but they may enroll themselves of their own volition.
I suspect that mortgage companies will probably update those requirements as the weather gets worse.
Very possible.
Risk assessment. I mean, we're talking about resilience to protect people and property from injury and damage to property and injury to people. And if you want to do a major renovation in a home that's in a 100-year floodplain, do you have a lot of choice? I think Monica's point is that if you do it, you're putting more money at risk and have a difficulty in selling your property. But if you don't do it, a buyer is going to take that into account and will offer less for that property. You know, I think we're getting into a lot of weeds here on the fly, and this needs some proper, careful consideration. I'm not in the business of writing regulations on the fly as we go through these meetings, these virtual meetings. It just doesn't make sense. It would be better if we asked Taylor to go back after this meeting and update the draft with careful thought and time, update the draft with the things we've asked him to do.
I apologize for the barking dog in the background.
I liked Bernie's idea. If you do have time to think that through in the 500-year plan, attaching it to a basement renovation, something more specific for just these current structures, again, the 30 to 40 that are in town.
Well, I would just put the qualifier on that Jessica made a good point that I guess it depends on where the first floor elevation is. You know, if the first floor elevation is lower than the 500-year flood, then I think that you've got to include the first floor in that discussion. because it doesn't make sense to put a whole bunch of money into the first floor if the first floor is lower than that elevation without having to do all this other stuff.
I'm sorry, Bernie, I had to step away for a second with a barking dog and a two-year-old is trying to sleep. So I had to go take care of that real quick. But I imagine you were echoing your point from earlier, and I will, I can certainly try to find a compromise and redraft some language here and get it back to you folks. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I was echoing my comment, but I was also tacking on Jessica's comment on the first floor. And what I was saying was that, you know, if the first floor elevation is below the 500-year flood, then it makes sense to include that. When I was discussing the basement, I was conceptualizing it as, you know, the basement is below the flood elevation, but the first floor is above. But Jessica brought up the good comment that if the first floor is within that elevation, then it should be included in the discussion, I guess. Is that accurate, Jess?
Yeah.
There's a comment in the chat from Ray Gonda that might help us.
Yeah, thanks, Michael.
Shall we move on from basements?
I think Michael had a good point that, you know, we've kind of beat this quite a bit, that I think there's a lot for you to chew on and come back with, I guess.
Yeah, okay. Is there anything else that you felt like you needed to point out to us, Taylor, from your
I have one other error that I'll point out that I made, and that's down here under other applicable standards. This reference to an A zone is incorrect. I believe that should be to a B2 zone. So areas that are in your 500-year floodplain that are not developable. I've restructured your non-conforming structure section just to better comply with the NFIP itself and link to your other non-conforming section and the rest of the bylaw. And then under your certificate of occupancy regulations here, I've just clarified that an elevation certificate or a floodplain, a floodproofing certificate. You can only do floodproofing for commercial and industrial uses. That those documents be filed with the administrative officer before CO instead of a zoning permit. They wouldn't have those documents at zoning permit. So those are the major changes from my perspective. Any other just general comments or questions for me?
No. Paul?
Just one really quick note for commissioners. I think that this is an appropriate use of a certificate of occupancy, but as we, as the commission, you know, applies rules like this and you expand to the 500-year, South Burlington doesn't do certificates of occupancy for single and two family homes typically, but they do it on a case-by-case basis on specific things like floodplains. Or as it relates to inclusionary units and things like that. And so with each amendment that you make that expands that a little bit, the role of the administrative officer there expands a little bit. We're only talking about 30 or 40 homes, but 30 or 40 homes plus other projects, we're slowly, you know, moving towards a direction where more homes do require certificate of occupancy, which is an administrative I don't want to say the word burden because burden is the wrong word, but it is an administrative cost. So just keep that in mind as you're thinking about all these kinds of things.
Okay. Well, thanks so much, Taylor. That was really helpful.
No problem. I'll go ahead, Ted.
Yep. I'm sorry. One question is that Taylor's going to look over the rest of it, but we're about to go into Article 12, which has a lot of areas which are Taylor's expertise. And I guess my big question is, you know, we're doing things sort of on the fly. Is it would it be beneficial for us to have him look at Section 12 before we spend several hours delving into it? Just a question for Paul and Jessica.
So I guess two things. One, we have already asked Taylor to review Article 12 later this month. And so, yes, we will absolutely do that. In terms of the detailed language, I guess I would suggest that you keep that in mind, and to sort of Michael's point from before, when you see yourselves potentially getting into the weeds of, is this standard strong enough, et cetera, maybe sort of flag that and say, let's have Taylor look at that. I do think that there are some important policy level discussions for you guys to have that don't necessarily rely on that, that aren't necessarily about getting in the weeds. For example, some of the recommendations that that Michael has put forward are really sort of big picture policy questions for you to tackle, but I will happily also share any commissioner feedback directly with Taylor so that he's got that in mind as he's thinking about this stuff. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Because I think, you know, for example, Michael's suggestion of expanding the width of a buffer is really, you know, that's a policy question. We can help you analyze the impacts of it, but the policy is really yours to think about.
And you're right, Paul, it plays into this because it's it adds to resilience and adds flood storage. The example you gave adds flood storage capacity should it be needed if you have a wider buffer. And I think Taylor would pick up on that.
That said, if you are looking for for example, Michael, or I know Monica's got some feedback also, if you are looking for an expert to evaluate it and say, hey, before we dive too deeply into it, what do they think of this? I'm also happy to give that to Taylor. So I'll really, you know, as you guys choose.
Well, I certainly think it would be useful to have his views on the suggestions that I've made, and probably Monica feels the same way about the suggestions she's made, which I haven't seen, but I would assume it's always good to have a second opinion or a second view at least.
Yeah, so I think we're about to expand the view to six more commissioners on both of what you're going to tell us. It does feel like we as a commission should probably talk about your suggestions before having Taylor, giving him multiple versions of things to wade through.
That's fine.
Right. Or at least get a commission nod that a group of suggestions is something that you would like to explore further, rather than just individual commissioners, because I think that's where we'll wind up spending a lot of time with Taylor, not necessarily making progress unless we have a sense that the commission's interested in exploring something.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, thanks so much, folks, for your time tonight. I'll work with Paul to kind of set a schedule for these last couple changes to Article 12, or sorry, Article 10. I look forward to reviewing Article 12 when I can grab a second around the holidays and getting feedback to you guys. All right.
Thank you very much.
Awesome. Thanks, folks.
Appreciate it.
Okay, so on to our discussion on Article 12. So I know it's really late, but I do think that it might make sense to do at least three things. One is, so I know that Monica has some things about the connections, because she had emailed about that, and Michael has some comments that he had redlined and sent to everyone. Do other people have some like kind of prepared like comments and or topics that they really want to focus on in this discussion? Just trying to get a sense of like kind of what our scope here is. Okay, and so I guess what I was thinking is Monica's connection thing seems pretty discreet, and she actually sent a map. So it seems like it might make sense to actually pull that up, look at the map, and just see if people agree that those connections might make sense to add or not. And then I think it makes sense to maybe hear an overview from Michael about his general ideas. kind of what the big picture is there, and then maybe have a short discussion about, you know, if we need more information or how we want to exactly approach the comments there, because I think it's probably more than we'll get to tonight, but it might be good to have some initial feedback on, like, you know, the approach we want to go on to get through those, and any other comments that people have as well, if that makes sense. Okay, so Monica, the connection idea, do you want us to pull up that map that you had sent?
Yeah, I mean, I basically thought there were two areas where connections were not mapped that probably should be, and I realized that because of zoning with parks and this, there kind of is naturally a connector right now, but it just seems like it would be worth, they are connectors. Do I pull that up or how? There it is. Okay. These are just done with, I don't even know what app I was using to make that, but the two black marks are, we know that there is connectivity. They can move, but it's important to at least, I think, document that those two areas have a lot of wildlife connection. So as long as they're following the same rule that they, you know, they can be adjusted, it's not like an exact location, I would just appreciate if those two could be added to our connections.
So just to be clear, Monica, you're talking about this from a, on the zoning side, not just sort of on the plan side, but that there be some regulatory requirement that applies in these two areas.
Right. The same way that we've added the other light green connector, like if you look up at the one going from the Eastwoods down to the Spear, whatever they were going to call that. If yep. that official connector, and I know Arrowwoods didn't document it, but those are two areas that they just may not have seen them because they're kind of off roads, and other people may have other connections or connectors that they know about as well. So if you were to apply that, you know, zoning criteria, whatever, to these two other areas in some way, connecting the one UVM parcel down to the Hort Farm, there's a lot of connectivity there, and generally it's off of, it doesn't happen through the parks and such. I mean, a moose will show up occasionally, but it's generally happening where people and cars and dogs are not in both of these cases. So like through the solar farm down there off of Dorset, I think that's where I put that. There's a lot of connectivity.
The solar farm is over here, Monica, just to, yeah.
So, well, but it's, okay. I mean, maybe that one has the, maybe people feel that that's enough connectivity, but I think from those, that large hazard arm that's coming out is, there is definitely a lot of connection there. So I don't want to spend too much time on it. If people disagree, that's fine. But those two areas seem to be missing documented connectivity. If zoning has ever changed and whatever, at least having those marked, I think, would be important.
And Monica, the one
can I just?
I'm sorry. The ones on the left. What is that? Is that along Spear Street or?
Well, no. Spear Street is farther over to the east. Like the pen right now is on. So it's really when you're over in the UVM field, the Wheelock field, and you have right. you go around like Szymanski and oh, right, Szymanski right. in the orange, yep. but okay. that's where there's a lot of traffic, and that's not where a lot of the wildlife connection is. It mm-hmm. really goes behind the condominiums. There's, you know, where nobody is, and then it digs down under fences as well, kind of across some of the bike path down into the Hort Farm.
Right.
So it's kind of behind the yeah. scenes connection.
Is it behind Stonehenge and then down to the Hort Farm?
It's not, is Stonehenge the condos? Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's between the condos and Spear Street. It's really going through people's, yeah. like the edge of people's backyards there at the just at the yeah. very border. Mm-hmm.
So, got it. The one on the right hand, I don't quite see where that goes. Let me bring it.
I mean, north Ernie? Of Chittenden Cider Mill.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yeah, there's no development in there right now. And it can, again, it can move, but the point is there is a lot happening behind that development that connects over to that other habitat. So
it's yeah, sort of from the southern end of Butler, Butler Drive. Mm-hmm. Okay, got it.
So I guess the two questions for you to consider, if you think about that one in particular, is there are one or two parcels that are relatively large in front of Butler Farms that could be neighborhood development. So to think about that, this would reduce that, which is okay, but just consider that. And also that right sort of in the middle of that U shape is a planned roadway connector between Butler Farms and if ever there was a neighborhood to the south, and how you would want to treat that. Would you want to allow it but have it be narrow? Would you want in a habitat connector to not allow it at all, which would then preclude the neighborhoods being connected by roadway? Just sort of thinking about those trades, which you know, that's the fun and challenging part of planning. And then I think Monica, for the one over on the west, a little bit better understanding of where your sense of where the wildlife passes, because I think that this while the path can move in a regulatory environment, it still is applied to a given property that, you know, it's a restriction that they then have to take care of. I might suggest that when I looked at the other ones, I talked with Jens Hilke. I'd be happy to visit that with him myself. He also offered anytime that the commission would like him to come chat with you all, he's offered to come back and do that. So I'd probably, if the commission's okay with it, at least start with a conversation with he and I to think about what that might look like, if commissioners are interested. And then you can decide if you want to schedule him to come in at some time.
Yeah, Bernie? I'm very familiar with the west one. I can show you on a satellite more specifically. This other side, it stood out to me, and I think it's like not something that you'd see from the road. So that's why I wondered if maybe they didn't map that. But I hear what you're saying about the connectivity.
Bernie? Yeah. So I guess my question, mainly Monica, and it relates to Paul's suggestion about having Jens get involved, is you know, what was the basis for these two lines? Is it anecdotal evidence or personal observation or feedback from a lot of people or game cameras, or in other words, what's the scientific basis for these?
Good question. And I mean, I did not seek scientific evidence for this. So I know that I'm very familiar with this particular area. I don't live in anywhere connected to this line, by the way, but I'm very familiar with this area. And what concerned me is that we do have zoning that kind of naturally creates the connection that is used, because you go from green to orange, kind of through a little bit of white down to more where the Hort Farm is. So zoning is what is creating right now or protecting the connection that's there. But if any of that ever changes, that's where I felt the Article 12 should be identifying the connectivity. I would venture to guess that a lot of people who live right in here would be able to provide, there may be footage actually, we can look for more scientific data to support that. But I
Yeah, I'm all for, you know, providing connections, you know, where we know connections need to be and where they make sense. So, you know, from that perspective, I don't have a problem with it. I just, you know, want to make sure that they're kind of documented connections, because, you know, that one on the west, you know, you can kind of jump from green to orange and work your way up as wildlife, but, you know, you've kind of observed that maybe they're doing an end run. I guess, especially since, you know, when we do make these connections, are then tying it into regulation, I would want to have some basis to be able to do that that's somewhat defensible. And you know, maybe having Paul talk to Jens and having him look at it and provide his input makes some good sense. I just think that, you know, obviously if you're a property owner along one of your black lines there, they're going to say, well, you know, what's the basis for you saying this? And it would be good to have something defensible for that.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Okay.
Well, this is Ray. I'd like to make a comment.
Sure, Ray.
I don't know. I'm not sure if you're all aware of it, but I am the chair of the Natural Resources Committee and Conservation Committee. And one of our major tasks for the coming year, hopefully the first half of the year, is to do exactly what we're talking about here. Try to map out the connections between habitat blocks. Much of that work has already been done, but there are a few places that need some extra work, and Monica's pointed out a couple of them. So I just want you to know that somebody else besides you folks will be doing something about this in terms of the research.
Ray, I guess I have a question for you. Do you feel like maybe with our draft map with the light green connections as is, that's like a good starting point for you to then kind of identify these areas similar to how Monica has the black lines? Or do you think we should go ahead and talk to Jens and see about adding those connections where the
black lines? I think both things you said are true. It's a good starting point. Yes, go ahead and talk to Jens. But what I'm saying is that I have a little problem, with all due respect, Bernie, I have a little problem with citing scientific evidence. Okay, if somebody goes out and takes some pictures with a game camera at night, is that scientific evidence?
Yeah, I think so. I'm not looking to have like a specialist paid, you know, $50,000 to go out and
right.
do it. All I'm looking for is there compelling evidence? And yeah, it can be game cameras.
Okay,
if,
good.
You know,
that's,
if there's
that's
a lot of people in the neighborhood that have observed things, I mean, that's fine. I just, you know, I think we have to have, you know, some rationale for why we're drawing these lines. And if
agreed.
It's, you know, people that live along there see moose every day, well, that's good enough for me. So,
I'd just like to add to what Bernie was just saying, that, you know, Jens did note when he talked with us a while ago, that it's important also to look at what those indicators are, that there can be multiple indicators. And that, you know, I think of the moose that showed up in the Staples parking lot a few years ago. A visit by a wildlife doesn't necessarily mean that it's good habitat, but there can be good evidence that creates it. And drawing that distinction is pretty important, because we do, all of us, see some level of wildlife in our backyards. And so being able to know, establish a threshold for this is when we're applying a regulatory tool to it is pretty important.
Well, and if we don't want to hold up Article 12, but if we knew that the Natural Resources Committee was looking at that, and that connections can be added once verified to a certain level or something, as long as there's that flexibility and that we're not missing anything important and then miss the opportunity to protect it in time.
Right. Well, there can be additions at later date, I'm sure. I mean, this isn't a once you decide here the connection, it's not going to be totally cast in concrete forever. Or is it?
No, I think that's a really good point, Ray, and we would definitely welcome input from your committee, especially, you know, what you're talking about.
Has Ray's committee seen Article 12, the markup?
We're a brand new committee.
Okay.
And we're basically just getting organized, and our first major task is reviewing the Bryan Eastview project.
I did meet Ted with Ray and his group last week to give them an overview. And so we went through all the various different maps, and I said to them that I would share this draft that you're looking at right away with them. So,
great. Thanks.
Michael?
For everybody, Sophie Mazowita did a comprehensive survey of wildlife in South Burlington and where and when they travel, you know, day or night, or and what routes they use. And I believe she produced a map that showed where they were and what species they were, where they were sighted and what species, from rabbits to otters to fishes. I mean, it would be that might be the kind of information or evidence that Bernie has mentioned. It could provide us with. It's not anecdotal. It's an actual record. Might be quite useful. I don't know. Paul, do you still have that?
I'll have to look and see. I recall it being done, but I don't remember if I received a copy of it. I was thinking, as you were saying this, that depending on the format of it, it might be pretty neat to overlay that with the maps and see, you know, how the two things line up.
Yeah, I'll do a hunt for it as well, and if I can, because I remember it quite clearly, and if I can find it, I will send it around.
Okay. Please do.
It does seem like that makes sense to do before we're sending this out. Okay.
There's also iNaturalist, which is a database of sightings. And it's been extended for the past couple of years from Burlington into South Burlington. And also, a lot of people, you know, just a search, how would I say it? I sent an email out on, not an email, but an FPF post out asking anybody if they've seen any fishers. And I got 8 emails back. And it turns out just by that one little question on FPF, I was able to document that people had seen fishers for the past decade in this area. And some sent pictures. It turned out that particular one was an otter, but there are ways of gaining information that are pretty straightforward and simple.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm done.
Thanks so much, Ray. I think that'll be really helpful. I'm glad we have a committee started back up. So next thing, Michael, do you want to give kind of a just general overview of your thinking on your draft? I know you have a lot of specifics and it's getting late, so we might not want to go through all of them right now. But
what was that?
We might not want to go through line by line, but you know, it seems like maybe you had a viewpoint.
It's pretty much what I covered in my cover note attached to this, which was to focus on the protection side of the standards and make them more resilient than is absolutely required. For example, you know, I mentioned earlier that somebody, when Taylor was talking, we talked about flood resilience and flood storage, that you wouldn't want to do anything that would interfere or reduce flood storage capacity. Well, some of the things that I'm recommending, which are in terms of wider buffers, have that effect and add to resilience, because we're going to be needing more, better, stronger resilience in our natural resources, and our own backyards, I guess, but we're talking about natural resource protection here. In the years to come, we've seen some major rain events already. The one that took out the bridge between us and Williston, another one that was fortunately able to be absorbed from north to south in the Great Swamp and the golf course and properties south of the golf course, but the flooded area was like 10 or 20 times the width of the stream that normally carries that water. So it's resilience and focus on protection, not so much on where can we accommodate. Obviously, we need to have that, but my secondary thought is, where can we accommodate development? So that was that's what sort of guided me in this, as well as the recommendations in some of the reports that the commission and the city has paid for and commissioned in the past from outfits like Arrowwood and our own open space committee report of some years ago. There's a lot of good material in there, a lot of good recommendations in there, which we should take into account. So resilience and strengthening protection. Now, the downside of that might be that we make it more difficult for exceptions. Certainly in the comments I've made, I've suggested that some of the exceptions which allow encroachment or development be eliminated, because I mean the objective is to protect the resource, not let's figure out how we can maybe protect it a little bit but allow some encroachment or development. That's the gist of it. At some point we'd have to go down the pages, you know, one at a time, and deal with each of these issues. And tonight's not the night, because we're going to run out of time any minute. We still have minutes to approve, etc. But that's what that's the background to why I made all these. And I think I mentioned to Jessica that I find it quite challenging to do this during an online virtual meeting on the fly. I need to have the time to sit back and read carefully. That may apply to all of us, I don't know. Maybe the rest of you are more facile, have greater facility with this, since you live in a younger and more modern world than I do.
It's a generational thing for sure.
Yeah. I'm not an old fogey yet, but I'm passionate and I'm going to fight.
Monica?
I just wanted to say, when I was looking at Michael's notes, and then I also watched your presentation last night to the city council, which was fantastic. There was something that jumped out to me that connects this thought, and I don't know where that chart, you started the presentation with a chart, like a summary chart, and that's not going to be in the LDRs, right? That was just for the presentation?
No, it actually is. It's the first table.
So here's where I think I'm about communication, and you use the phrase no build. You know, you said a level one is no build, but then to Michael's point, it's actually no build with exceptions. And I think that's what we just have to be really careful about, because in fact, we're not saying, right now the regulations are not written as completely no build in certain cases. But words no build are very, very clear to people, and that's what their expectations will be. So I was kind of keeping those in mind when I did look through what Michael had to say, because he's definitely on the path of the no build.
So I guess, yeah, I think really good point for both of you. So I think that a lot of Michael's suggestions fall into kind of two categories from what I can tell. One was kind of increasing buffers for a bunch of the different resources, and then also taking a really closer look back at the encroachments that we have as allowable in certain circumstances, and really think as a group about, you know, do they still make sense? You know, we talked about them so long ago, like before we really kind of dove in. So it does to me seem to make sense to like revisit those. And Michael's gone through with a fine tooth comb for himself, but I think as a group, it might make sense to really look back at those encroachments and see, you know, do we really think they're still important in certain circumstances or not? So, Paul?
And I think that, you know, this is maybe where Ted's question from a little while ago comes in, of getting feedback and direction from the commission about what levels of encroachment is very valuable, if that's a policy decision, choosing the words as to how to enact that and implementing that is something that we can give to Taylor and have him do it, so that we're not sort of saying, well, should it say XXX or should it say YYY? But the question of should a roadway be allowed to cross a wetland is a policy question.
Yeah.
Does that sort of answer your question from earlier, Ted, about how to not get deeply into the weeds?
Yep.
Okay. Because I think that would be great. And I guess my question for commissioners is, it might not be immediately, but at some point we would happily, if you wanted, map any of the things that are being talked about. So
The Paul's example is well taken, because in what section is this, in one of them I actually say that roadway paved surface shall be no wider than 20 feet and shall not cross or bifurcate a wetland or wetland buffer. That's where restricted infrastructure encroachment is covered.
Yeah, so I think we're probably not going to get into the details tonight, and we're going to have to talk about it again, but it does seem like maybe between now and then we can all maybe be thinking about that, and you know, Michael's provided some comments for food for thought for like some specifics.
So I guess my last question for you, as it's 9:20, was you had contemplated at your last meeting the idea of having an additional meeting, you know, knowing that you're not meeting the week of the 25th, of possibly having a meeting next week to sort of make sure that you're making headway. That might be a good meeting at which to go through Article 12 in some more policy level detail, if you wanted to meet.
Then we should have only one item on the agenda.
Well, I might suggest we have this, but if we get through this, then maybe a couple other things we can knock off.
You're good thinking.
At another meeting, you mean?
I think having a whole meeting to deal with this is probably a good idea.
Yeah.
I think it's going to take a while.
Yeah. Okay.
Is Monday a council night?
It is not a council night next week, no.
Monday the 14th. I don't have a ton of availability, but even if you pick a night I'm not available, you could go forward. So
I'm available any night next week.
Monday's not good for me.
I'm pretty easy the whole week.
I'm busy every night next week because, you know, I'm old. I go to bed at 7 o'clock. Any night next week is good for me. Well, okay. there's an energy committee meeting on Tuesday, which we should not clash with.
Okay. Do you want me to send out a doodle poll to folks tomorrow morning?
Sounds like we might.
Let's do that.
We know that are good already, but and Monday and Tuesday aren't good. So it's either the rest of that week, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
I'll send a doodle poll and I'll be.
Does Wednesday work? Is Wednesday good for everybody?
Not for me. I think we're going to have to do a doodle poll. Sorry, we'll just do everything. Good try. Okay, so we do have some minutes. Do we have a motion for the minutes?
I'll move to approve the minutes of the 24th of November.
Second.
Okay, any discussion on the minutes?
No, but clerk is really easy in COVID because I don't even have to sign anything.
Okay, all in favor, aye?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, unanimous, perfect, wonderful. Anything else?
Yes, do I have permission to go and have my nightly beer?
Yes, no. I thought you went to bed at 7.
That's your bedtime, Michael.
I normally have it a little earlier in the evening, around 6.
All right. Hey, thanks everybody, and please check your email tomorrow morning. I'll send out a meeting invite, and I'd love to get the it'll probably be basically the same packet with also links to Monica and Michael's comments so that everybody's got it, but I'd like to get that to you ASAP so people have as much time as they can have.
And all Monica's right. Map, you had 2 maps, right? You had a couple of maps we were supposed to send.
I'll provide the things that Monica gave me so that you're in so that you've got it, as long as that's okay with you, Monica.
Yeah, that's fine.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. And if anybody else has comments that you want to share, please get them over to me.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Night.